So, George, when did you know you wanted to do country music for a living, and how did it actually start for you?
Well, I didn't realize that you even got paid for it. You know, at the beginning, I started off singing in churches and things like that, and I got to hearing, you know, Roy Acuff and all of them on the Grand Ole Opry. And I got my first guitar when I was about 9 or 10 or something like that. And I fell in love with it, and I took that guitar with me everywhere I went. It was a little, had horses on it and ropes and Gene Autry's name, and it was Gene Autry guitar, and I would take that to school with me. I'd hide it out in the little patch of woods and pull leaves over it to hide it so nobody would come along and steal it.
So then you'd go to school and come back afternoon and get the leaves?
Go to school and spend a half a day, and then I'd come back and play hooky, get the guitar. And I did play hooky too much. I just loved that guitar. And the evangelist, the preacher's wife, Sister Annie, and she taught me the basic chords like G, C, D, and A, and what have you, F. And it all just came to me like it was just normal, you know. And that's when I started traveling. When we moved into Beaumont, the big city, you know, from Kuntz, I lived out in the country. We moved in there, and I got to know everybody by taking that guitar with me on the bus, the city bus lines. And they got to where they knew me, and then didn't cost me nothing. So I spent my days, you know, going back towards the back of the bus, get back there and just start playing and singing, and everybody acting like they enjoy it. And I thought that was the greatest feeling in the world, you know. So I'd go to the end of one bus line, get on another bus, go to the end of it. And finally I'd get on the right one to get back home. And it was just, I just loved it so much, couldn't stay away from it.
Was there a moment in time along the way in those early years where you said, okay, I've made it, I'm gonna have some staying power in country music business and make a name for myself?
Well, I started playing the taverns and little things like that, just to get some, just cause I love to do it. You know, mm-hmm. I didn't even know you're supposed to get paid. I was still naive about all that. And, but then as I got a couple of years older, you know, you hear about these things, the Grand Ole Opry going to Tennessee, and oh man, wouldn't that be something, you know? And of course we got to thinking about, after I got out of the Marine Corps, they got in touch with me on Starday Records and wanted to see me when I got home. And I had my first recording session in 54. And in a living room of a house. They had egg crates all over the wall to soundproof it a little, but you can still hear the 18-wheelers go by. And sometimes we'd have to stop and wait till that was over. But if you listen to some of them old things, you know how rough and tough it was back then. They're terrible. And but anyhow, you know, when we got our chance to come and do a song on the opera, when I had finally got Why Baby Why going, and that was the biggest thrill, you know, just to see your name in the charts, you know, and people talking about it. And oh my goodness. And then I found out you can get money for it then.
And then you realized how much money you'd missed out on all that money along the way too. That occurred to you.
I didn't know you got paid for doing something you just loved to do so much. You know?
Something you'd have done for free and hadn't been doing for free.
Yeah, and did it a lot of times too.
What are some highlight moments? Obviously, that when you talk about playing the Opry the first time, along the way in your career to this point where you just turned 75, you were at the Opry. People came out on stage, much like the God's Country Project, your friends and contemporaries, as well as newcomers who've been influenced by George Jones. And you sat there in front of them and put the pressure on them. You know, they were performing before the master. That's kind of, from the beginning, which you just described, to that point in time. What are some of the highlights?
Well, right, that too, I'm glad you brought that up, because I sit out right in front center of the stage. I sit out in the seats, about the second row or what have you. And all of these artists, a lot of the same ones that are on this God's Country album, they did a birthday thing for me, and they sang my songs, and it was refreshing to hear them then, and I'm sitting out there and watching them while they do it. And it's a big honor. They've been awful nice to me here in Nashville.
You've been recognized along the way for your work by the President of the United States. How'd that make you feel?
Well, that was a sort of a weird feeling.
You're not comfortable weird, in that situation, are you? You don't particularly like that, do you?
I was trying to get out of there. I'm funny about things like that. And my wife says, "He's talking to you, George." And he said something to me, "Come on back, George. We got to take the pictures yet." And we hadn't took the pictures. I was ready to get out of there. See, I done turned around, took three or four steps to the door.
You're breaking protocol.
Yeah. Oh, me. But, things like that, I don't know why they do that. But like the first time I went on the Grand Ole Opry, I was so thrilled to get that chance. And they told me I couldn't play my guitar. And I said, I can't do nothing with my hands. I'm a nervous wreck already. And George Morgan and little Jimmy Dickens was standing there talking with me, trying to get me calmed down. And I said, I don't know what I'm gonna do. I've always wanted to be on the opera. I just can't go out there without a guitar. Well, one or the other threw a guitar around my neck and says, "We'll take responsibility. You wasn't supposed to play unless you belonged to the union, But I was just a guest. They should have realized I didn't know anything about that yet.
And you hadn't even been paid.
Yeah, I didn't know I was even going to get a check for singing that two songs.
What runs through your mind when you realize the new artists are performing in your presence and how nervous you make them, but you don't mean to, when they walk in there and they look you in the eye and they start to perform?
Well, that was, you forget all that stuff, and then you think back. Well, when I was a kid, I first met Hank, at a radio station, where he had time to sit down and talk a few minutes with you. And he had to be the nicest guy I've ever met in my life. So down to earth, so honestly talking,
Unassuming.
Yeah, yeah. It's hardly playing. Nothing was no put on about him or all this stuff, And he had a big hit out at the time called Wedding Bells. I was going to play guitar with him on this radio show. Well, he had his guitar and he just started singing, "I've got the invitation that you sent me, a wedding bell." And I'm standing the other side of the mic. That's when the mic came out of the ceiling.
Right.
And I'm standing there ready to kick it off. Instead, he starts singing. So, that beat me out of the kickoff, I rehearsed and rehearsed. And come to find out, he finished the song and I haven't hit a note. Not a note. Well, I just stared at him. I was amazed.
If you had to pick, three songs that would be favorites of yours along the way, not necessarily your own songs, but songs of anybody. You've talked about Lefty and Mr. Acuff and Hank and Webb Pierce and people like that. It could be something relatively new even. What would they be? I hate to, limit you to three.
I can sit here all day and name you songs that like that, but the ones I can think of right now would be songs like Hank had, Hank Williams Sr., you went again. Of course, everything he put out was a hit with me. Mm-hmm. I mean, everything on his albums. You know, he hit, he not only had a hit on a single, everything on his albums hit. And nobody's ever done that, never will. But, of course, the business wasn't that large like it is now.
Yeah.
But Today I Started Loving You Again, that's one of my favorites of Merle Haggard. And Vince Gill, When I Call Your Name.
No.
You can name songs like that all day. There are a bunch of them.
What's your favorite Lefty Frizzell song?
My favorite? Well, every one he put out was my favorite. Back at that small period of time that I was about 15 or 16 and at the most, and when he recorded, nobody's ever did this either. He had four songs, both sides of two singles, in the top five. You can go to the Hall of Fame and see this in the Billboard magazine. And he had Always Late, Mom and Dad's Waltz, Look What Thoughts Will Do, something else. But he had the 1, 2, 3, and 5 position. Hank Williams, Cold Cold Heart, was 4 coming up.
Boy.
And nobody's ever did that. Of course, like I say, that was back before the business grew and got so big. But I Love You 1,000 Ways and Always Late, I guess, was my favorite with him. Mm-hmm. Oh, and Mom and Dad's Waltz. I loved Mom and Dad's Waltz.
As we sit here, I was just thinking, your public life, private life, have both been chronicled so much through the years.
Well, it was a mess for years.
You can't live your life over. But people always want to know, if George Jones could do something differently in his life, would he?
I'm doing it. I did.
Well said.
I'm still working at a lot of other parts of it, but you know, Rome wasn't built in a day, so I'm I'm trying to get it all right before it's too late. I did quit smoking and drinking, and that's for sure, and I have no craving for it. You can, but I don't like, I can't stand the smell of smoke anymore.
Huh.
And I smoked for 50 years. And if you're over there, I can smell it, and it's terrible. So I'll walk off or get away from me.
What does country music mean to you? To so many people, what country music means to them is what George Jones has influenced them with, primarily. So many artists say that. You know,
well,
he is country music.
To start
he is what
with,
it's all about.
We need to get our identity back. We need that back awful bad. Traditional music is country music. It's been country music ever since it was thought of or even sung the first song. The money people, whatever you want to call them, they have come in since it's got built and strong and got on TV and all this stuff and it starts making money. That's when your big money people come in and take over, you know. And they want things this way and that way and the other way. And they need to find their own identity and give us ours back. And radio also needs to understand that. And get radio should get back to what made this business, traditional country music. Now, this music we have today, I love these people. Don't get me wrong. I don't mean to offend any of these new artists, but they are made to do this, what they're doing, or else they can't be on record. And some of them are very successful, and I'm not putting the music down itself. There's some good stuff out there, but it's got a different identity. And they need to find their own identity and kind of go wherever they want to go, New York, if they want to go there and hold the Academy Award show, I know a lot of people here would be glad to see them take it to New York and leave it there. But what I'm talking about is we need to get country back. We need to get it back. I'd love to see that before I die.
Really. How about an amen? Anybody? Huh?
Sometimes I say things that I shouldn't say. You have to stop me. I'm getting going.
Well, I hope you know how much you're loved.
Huh? Well, I love them too.
George Jones.
I really do.
An American icon.
Thank you, sir.
Making the world a better place.
Thank you, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, the Possum.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
All right. Well said.
From Lukenbach to Galilee.
The legend is back.
Jerusalem to Tennessee.
And this time, he brought friends.
And all points in between.
Country music superstars have joined forces with George Jones to sing the legend's smash hits on God's Country. Vince Gill.
Still can't.
Sammy Kershaw. And Mark Chestnut.
Through this world with me.
Tanya Tucker.
From the window up above.
Take me.
And Pam Tillis.
Take me to your darkest room.
Along with friends Joe Diffie, Garth Brooks, Tracy Lawrence, and more, God's Country includes a special behind-the-scenes DVD documentary you won't want to miss. God's Country on Category 5 Records. Available now wherever great country music is sold. God.